You don't expect it to begin here, in a landscape so quiet and sunbleached it feels like the last place on Earth that might hide a secret. Nothing about this place suggests depth or complexity or the vastness of an underground world. If anything, it looks like a place where things come to an end. And that's exactly why the truth hits so hard, because beneath this lonely slice of the Northern Territory lies one of the largest cave systems in Australia and one of the most extraordinary maze cave complexes anywhere on the planet. More than 123 kilometres of passages twist through a footprint only about 4 kilometres across. Bullita Cave is not just big, it's bewildering, and almost nobody outside the caving community knows it exists. What looks like a cracked, barren stone pavement beneath your feet is actually the roof of a labyrinth, and a cave beneath it isn't some ancient relic from deep geological time either. The oldest passages are younger than 2 million years, which in geological terms is practically the present moment. Beneath the Judbarra and Gregory Karst, an entire underground world spreads out just 10 to 20 metres below the surface, with an intricacy and density that feels impossible for such a thin slice of rock. Today, we're going to walk into this strange underworld, shaped by monsoon storms and guided by the layering of billion-year-old rocks, and explore one of the most unusual subterranean landscapes Australia has ever produced. The strangest thing about Bullita is how invisible it is from above. Stand on the Karen Field, the jagged stepping stone pavement of bare limestone, and you would never imagine that a maze of corridors, fissures and half-lit chambers lies just beneath. The rock underfoot is the Supplejack Dolostone Member, a 15 to 20 metre thick layer of Proterozoic carbonate whose internal layering and resistance to weathering have allowed it to form this harsh, open surface. Beneath it rests a 3 metre bed of soft shale, and that shale controls almost everything that happens inside the cave. According to the study that this video is based on, this bed acted first as a perched aquitard that guided early phreatic passage formation, and later as the soft, easily eroded layer that wet season floodwaters carved into the broad, flat-floored corridors characteristic of Bullita's middle levels. Because the shale is weak, the cave does not grow downward into great leaps. Instead, it spreads outward, forming huge horizontal mazes tucked just below the surface. These shallow depths mean daylight slides into the cave through roof cracks and roots dangle like curtains from the grikes above, creating a twilight underground that is both eerie and beautiful. The scale of the cave is astonishing because its footprint is so small. The entire maze is squeezed into a 4 kilometre wide belt beneath the Karen Field, creating a layout so dense that it's almost impossible to mentally map. It looks like a geological spiderweb. This density is not random. Bullita's passages follow joint sets in the Dolostone, producing rectangular grids and snaking networks that feel more architectural than natural. Most caves require thick limestone and broad phreatic zones to produce mazes like this, yet Bullita manages it in a rock layer thinner than a suburban house block is tall. It does this because it cheats. It has a rigid, jointed carbonate roof, a soft shale floor and an annual cycle of extreme wet season flooding. Heavy monsoonal rains drop into the Karen Field in short bursts, and the water vanishes almost immediately into the cracks. Because the water's travel time is short, it reaches the cave still chemically aggressive and capable of dissolving carbonate rock quickly. Floodwater ponds beneath sediment dams at the western edge of the Karen Field, holding this corrosive water inside the cave for weeks or even months. That flood and drain rhythm shapes the cave each year in alternating phases of dissolution, flooding and collapse. Over time, the passage floors widen while the roof remains narrow, producing the signature inverted T-shapes and tented passages that form some of Bullita's most recognisable features. The rock layers controlling this cave are part of the Skull Creek Formation, a Proterozoic sequence of Dolostone, Limestone and Shale. Only one of those layers, the Supplejack Dolostone Member, develops strong karst and cave systems. The reason is its internal architecture. It consists of finely layered micritic limestone interbedded with equally fine dolomite beds. Underground, these alternating layers produce a vertically striped pattern where some beds dissolve more easily than others. The alternating hardness creates ledges, projecting ribs, and the distinctive A-shaped fissures that define so many of Bullita's passages. But the shale below is the master architect. This 3 metre thick bed is both an aquitard and an easily eroded pathway. It guides water, shapes the geometry of the tunnels, and eventually collapses once undermined, dragging the Dolostone roof with it. One of the most haunting aspects of the terrain is the degraded karst zone on the western edge of the Karen Field. Here, what used to be cave is now open to the sky. Passages have lost their roofs, leaving canyons called giant grikes, some more than 5 metres wide and as deep as the cave itself. The pinnacles between them stand like broken towers, Sediment fills the space between these blocks, creating natural levees that trap wet season flood water inside the cave's remaining corridors. This zone represents the death of the cave. At the opposite edge, on the eastern side, new passages are still forming. Bullita grows and collapses sideways, not downward, following the slow retreat of the land surface. The surface itself tells the story of this time-slice evolution. The Karen field above Bullita is divided into four zones, each marking a stage in the life cycle of both the landscape and the cave beneath. Closest to the source of retreat, where the upper Skull Creek rocks have only recently peeled away, the Supplejack is exposed as a relatively smooth pavement dotted with massive stromatolite domes. Beneath it, the cave barely exists, with only tiny proto-passages beginning to form. Further west, the surface becomes rougher, cut by deepening grikes and sharp blade-like pinnacles. This is the midlife of the cave, where tented passages and triangular fissures develop most strongly. Beyond that lies a chaotic forest of 2-metre spitzcairn towers and deep, joint-controlled fissures. Below this zone, the shale-floored corridors spread out into wide, rectangular passageways. Finally, at the far western edge, the degraded karst takes over. There, huge blocks separate into ruined city-like patterns, and the cave beneath is unroofing faster than it can grow. Walk inside the cave and the passage types tell the same story. Passages carved in the lower Supplejack form triangular, A-shaped fissures lined with delicate ledges, controlled by the fine layering of limestone and dolostone. Some widen downward into tent-shaped forms where the shale once held the water table. Others form beautiful omega-shaped tubes perched just above the shale bed, relics of an earlier phreatic stage. Drop down into the shale itself and you enter another world entirely. Here, water is scoured broad, rectangular corridors that can reach 30 meters wide, with flat ceilings marked by open joints. These passages feel like buried hallways or railway tunnels. In some places, only thin pillars of shale remain to keep the ceiling aloft. Deep beneath this, close to major gorges such as Limestone Creek and the East Baines River, the cave digs briefly into the lower Skull Creek Dolostone. These lower passages are narrower and simpler, and they represent Bullita's experiments with depth, occurring mainly where the land surface above has been steeply incised. The hydrology of Bullita binds everything together. Although the cave is dry and dusty during the long dry season, there is overwhelming evidence that wet season storms flood many passages to the ceiling. The cave's water enters by two main routes. Some plunges straight down through the Karen field into a diffuse, rapid, and nearly vertical fashion. The rest arrives from small streams running off the less permeable upper Skull Creek rocks and entering the Karen field at its eastern edge. Once inside, the water encounters the shale bed and begins carving sideways. Floodwaters pool behind the sediment-choked ruiniform blocks of the western zone, filling sectors of the cave for weeks at a time. These seasonal lakes dissolve the carbonate walls far more effectively than the brief rains at the surface. Bullita's caves are shaped by storms that last hours, but whose floodwaters linger for months. As mentioned before, despite the billion-year-old host rocks, the cave itself is young. The scientific study that this video is based on concludes that the cave passages have a maximum age of about 500,000 to 2 million years. The cave and the Karen field evolve together as the Supplejack becomes exposed during slope retreat. New passages form in the freshly exposed zone, mature as they move westward, and eventually collapse and unroof in a degraded karst. In other words, the cave is constantly being born, aging and dying laterally along the landscape. Perhaps the most unexpected aspect of Bullita is its ecology. The surface is almost entirely bare rock, blasted by heat and devoid of soil. The cave floor, however, collects leaf litter, silt, chert fragments and organic debris washed down through the grikes. Roots from trees at the surface descend into the cave and spread across the floor, creating humid, nutrient-rich patches far below ground. This unusual configuration makes the cave floor, not the land above, the primary soil layer for the ecosystem. Biological surveys have already revealed more than 50 species of invertebrates, with several likely true cave specialists, which is impressive given how little biological exploration has occurred. In the end, what makes Bullita special is the way it breaks the rules. It is a sprawling maze cave formed in rock that is thin, shallow when close to the surface. It grows through a partnership of monsoon rains, soft shale, brittle dolostone, and a migrating land surface. It experiences seasonal flooding intense enough to mimic deep phreatic conditions, despite being only meters below daylight. It develops laterally, not vertically, and exists in a constant state of renewal and collapse, and it hides in plain sight beneath a landscape that looks like it should hold nothing at all. stand on the rocky pavement again after learning all this and the place feels different. The heat, the silence, the sharp edges of the grikes beneath your feet now hint at something far grander. The ground you're on is not a barren wasteland. It is the thin roof of an underground continent, still breathing, still growing, still collapsing, still alive with the rhythms of the monsoon. And even though Bullita lies hidden just a few meters below the surface, the truth is that it holds a world all of its own, carved in the dark by storms, stone and time. I hope you found this as interesting as I did, and as always, thanks for watching. Before I end this video, I'd like to give a big shout out to my Patreon and YouTube members. Thank you so much to everyone that helps to support this channel.